Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Shall we bring the meeting to order? I'm delighted today to introduce our guest speaker, Michael Coates. Can you hear me at the back, everybody? We're very pleased to have Michael here. I'm going to tell you a little bit about him before he begins. Named one of Canada's top 50 most powerful people by Canadian Business in 2014, Mike has provided advice and counsel to corporate boards like BHP Billiton, the Toronto Stock Exchange, and the Chinese National Overseas Oil Corporation, as well as serving on commercial, educational, and not-for-profit boards. Up until last week, he was global vice chairman of Hill+Knowlton Strategies, one of the globe's largest communications companies with over 3,000 employees and $380 million in revenue. He's worked at Hill+Knowlton for some time, having been President and CEO Americas, and President and CEO Canada. He is also on the board of CANDU, director on the advisory board of George Washington University Graduate School of Political Management, and a variety of others. And he's most distinguished of all, of course, because as all of you will follow careers like this, he's a graduate of the MPA program at Queen's, which gives you just about carte blanche in the work world. And today, Michael's going a very topical theme. The topic is managing risk, preventing political animals from running the zoo. Michael, it's all yours.
Very, thank you. Well, thank you very much, David. And it really is great to be here today. Where's Bob? Is he still here? Bob, you have Bob to thank for that title of today's presentation. You wanted something that he thought that was grabbing to the audience, so this is the one that we came up with. It really is a pleasure to be here at my old alma mater. When I attended a recent Queen's event in Ottawa, I think it was in January, I met a number of you at that time, and I was struck by how the interests of the students of today really haven't changed too much from when I was going to school, because most were interested in one thing: was this diploma going to lead to a job? And I'm here today to tell you that yes, it can. I loved my year at Queen's. The coursework was interesting, not terribly demanding, but what was really great were the people that I met during the year. Both people like myself that came in and did a little bit of teaching, but also the students. And it, in fact, was one of the students that I met during, there was a part-time program at that time, David, and he had a job on Parliament Hill. Now, I had no idea that, in fact, there were political aides. I thought MPs did all of this stuff themselves. And when I learned a little bit about what he did, I thought, yeah, that's what I'd like to do. I mean, planning and process of bureaucracy is very interesting and necessary, but I kind of like the sound and fury of Parliament. And so I got a little bit of advice from him, and I went to Parliament Hill. And I worked for two individuals that some of you may know. One was Perrin Beattie, who was a Minister of Defense for a period of time, and Health. And he taught me what the life of an MP should be like, and how an MP should behave. And then I went to work for somebody by the name of Lowell Murray, Senator Lowell Murray. And the good senator was Joe Clark's campaign chairman. Lowell taught me what politics was really like. And I learned the relationship between policy, research, and communications during that period of time. And after 3 years, I realized there was money in them there hills. I could turn everything that I learned into a profession. And at that time, 34 years ago, the whole profession of public affairs, government relations was just starting. So it was a great time for me to begin my career. Absolutely loved it. 34 years, as David indicated, just ended last year. I stepped down from H&K, but I'm here today to tell you that there is life after this program. Whether you decide to go into the public service or government, you can have a very good career. Take advantage of the people that you'll be meeting over the next little while in this program, because you will run into each other for the rest of your careers. And that is the most important thing, really, I think, about this program and your education here. Okay, so to the issue at hand. Bob was looking at my CV and he noticed that I had worked on something called CNOC, which is the Chinese oil company's acquisition of a company called Nexen. And he said to me, "Mike, so you're the guy who screwed up Canada's trade relationship with China. I'd like you to talk to us about that. What really took place?" So that's what I'm going to do for you here today. But I'm going to do it against the backdrop of the process that we always put our clients through when we do any sort of political risk mitigation. So you'll see that process as we go along here. So it's all about how we assess risk and then how we mitigate it, as well as some of the key factors that are driving the politicization of policy today. Because I think the process has become much more politicized than it has in the past. So, since Parliament began, it's been passing legislation to set up order in government, processes that government can follow. But no sooner do politicians pass this legislation than they're looking for ways around it, because they can never predict what is going to come up in the democratic process. And so today's case study, we're going to talk about how a piece of legislation, the Investment Canada Act, didn't quite satisfy what the government of the day, Mr. Harper's government, was looking for in order to provide political protection and comfort around the adjudication of this transaction. So, our case study, as I mentioned, is about the largest Chinese acquisition of a Western company. It was a $19 billion transaction that involved five regulatory jurisdictions: Canada, the United States, the EU, England, and China. All five had to approve this transaction, and we worked on every single aspect of that transaction. I'll just talk today about the Canadian side. Now, the story, I think, of the politicization of these types of transactions really begins in 2008. After the meltdown of our world global economy, we began to see, well before Trump, well before Brexit, protectionism begin to creep into the political process. And people began, the economists talked about this in 2013, putting up gates to restrict the movement of capital and labor. And it was into that type of environment that CNOC decided to proceed with their transaction. Now, this particular chart just shows you what happened to investment after the meltdown in 2008. There was a lot of foreign investment taking place in both the developing and the developed world, but you'll see that investment dropped right off in 2008 in the developed world and continued to grow in the developing world. There were two exceptions to that. One was Australia and one was Canada. And the reasons were Canada and Australia were resource rich. And the largest single driver of that foreign investment flow was China. And every single country was falling over themselves, trying to market themselves to China to get that investment to their countries. This particular chart just shows you the extent to which protectionism is on the rise around the world. Germany right now is almost in the process of turning down the merger of the LSE and Deutsche Börse because the United Kingdom had their Brexit vote. And they just no longer feel comfortable merging their exchange with a company that is owned and headquartered in London. The United Kingdom is right now bringing forward foreign investment legislation very similar to Canada and Australia. There's a new net benefit test that they're working on right now for companies that are coming in and wanting to buy British entities. So this rise of protectionism we're seeing right around the world. So into this came CNOC. Now, CNOC is a state-owned enterprise. It's 100% owned by the Chinese government. It operates, according to them, on a commercial basis. All of its loans are done on the international markets. They pay commercial rates, they pay tax, both in China and every single jurisdiction they're in around the world. They wanted to be treated like a private entity. Their management team was very Western. I got to know them very well and still do. Educated in Oxford, MIT, Harvard. These are very sophisticated business people. But the other thing to bear in mind about CNOC, it had just gone through a similar, through a transaction in the United States, the home of free enterprise, where they were stopped because they didn't adequately plan for the fallout that would come when they attempted to buy a very large US-owned conglomerate called Unical. And their application to the government to acquire Unical was stopped dead in its tracks. A lot of lobbying took place. The entire US energy industry came together, particularly Chevron, used their political contacts in Ottawa and stopped it dead. So CNOC decided, where else could they invest in North America and get a more welcoming reception? And they thought that Canada would be that place. And I have to admit, I thought it would be too, but I soon learned different. So, once they launched their transaction, Canadian officials who had this outward appearance of being very warm towards Chinese foreign investment soon began to change their tune because of political pressures domestically here in Canada. So, CNOC decided, after learning their lesson in the United States, they would come into Canada one step at a time. They made a small acquisition of a company called Opti, which Nexen was a part owner in. Now, Opti ran an oil upgrader in the oil sands. And they were short on cash to continue to develop that upgrader. So Nexen welcomed that capital coming into the country. So too did the government of Canada. So they allowed that transaction to go through. CNOC brought us to the table to help explain what the Investment Canada Act was all about, and to introduce them to some of the politicians and bureaucrats that would be adjudicating the act. After that was approved, it soon became apparent to us at H&K that we were part of a larger game. This was just step one. They asked us if Canada was ready to see a major Chinese transaction. I remember saying no. I thought you needed to be here another couple of years before you could successfully pull that off without a lot of risk. But the Chinese are very aggressive investors. When they set their minds on it, when they decide they want something, they rarely come in on a minority basis. They come in to buy a company outright. That's what they decided to do with Nexen. So, we took advantage of the fact that all governments in Canada were very determined to bring Chinese investment into their locales. So 6 months after our clients acquired Opti, we went around and saw all the different governments in Canada where Nexen had operations. So British Columbia, Alberta, the Canadian government, a little bit in Ontario. And we did similar types of visits in the United States. And we asked those government officials, how would you feel about a further CNOC investment? Oh, we love it. We'd love that to take place. Canada's open for business. The more, the better. So, we of course didn't tell them we had a transaction simmering on the back burner. So we decided it was a good environment to pull the plug. And we did. We launched this $19 billion transaction. It surprised the Canadian government. They didn't realize that we were talking about a takeover. I think they thought we were talking about $19 billion in greenfield money coming into the country. But once they had opened up the kimono, CNOC and all of their advisors came charging right in. Very shrewd move. Now, we were asked at that point to take them through a strategy, a process, where CNOC could consider all of the different risks that would be associated with this deal and devise a strategy to mitigate those risks. So this particular slide shows you all of the different steps that we went through in order to devise that plan. Very first thing we did is we got our teams, our GR teams, our PR teams, integrated with the lawyers and the bankers. We were one team. And we went on first name basis with the management of CNOC. We briefed the CNOC board. We had access right to the top with all the major Chinese officials. It was absolutely fascinating. They didn't approach this as a commercial transaction. They approached this really as a government relations exercise. The next thing we did is we conducted public opinion research because we knew that as soon as the balloon went up, there would be a lot of public discourse that would take place. And we wanted to know what we are up against and how we could shape and mold public opinion so that we could better make our case. So we did a lot of research. We did a risk assessment. I'll show you an outline of what that looks like in a second, where we tried to measure the intensity of the risks that we had, as well as the probability of us managing it. We developed a strategy and a plan from that research. Everything was research driven. And then an execution plan. What would we have to do to actually get this through the approval process? Now, I want to just digress just a touch here, because CNOC came in on the heel of another transaction that had just been turned down. And David mentioned that in his introduction remarks of me. BHP Billiton came into Canada and they attempted to buy Saskatchewan potash. The Harper government turned that down. And they turned it down because the Saskatchewan government decided that it just could not bear a former Crown corporation that had been privatized being sold off to a foreign entity, even an Australian entity. They just could not countenance that. I worked on that file too. I think we could have won that file had BHP Billiton approached it the same way that CNOC did. See, as I said, CNOC approached this as a government relations exercise. Billiton approached their acquisition of Saskatchewan potash as a pure commercial exercise. And so for them, it was all about price. And so they came into Canada, frankly, very arrogant, assuming they would get approval, basically telling the government of Canada why they should approve this transaction, and then threatening both governments that if approval wasn't given, the impact it would have on investment in Canada and the investment climate. They kept us at arm's length. They were frankly looking for a recommendation from us that was, I think, almost pro forma. It would get through so they could bring that to their board and say it would be okay to make this hostile acquisition, which is the other key difference between the BHP acquisition and CNOC. The BHP acquisition was hostile. It did not have Saskatchewan potash on board. CNOC watched all of that take place, and they learned. And they realized that what they had to do, one of the most critical things they had to do, was first pre-engage with government stakeholders, and then they had to have a friendly acquisition. And they managed to succeed in doing that. They brought Nexen on board at a very steep price. So, stage is set, they came in with the right frame of mind. We went to town, we did a lot of public opinion research, and we began to realize the difficulties we were going to have to actually sell this deal. Because while foreign investment generally is unpopular, nobody likes a Canadian company to be taken over, what we didn't fully realize, I think we bought a lot of Canadian rhetoric. What we didn't fully realize was the hostility that exists in Canada to the Chinese investment from mainland China. We soon found that 76% of Canadians would oppose a hypothetical takeover of a mid-sized Canadian oil and gas company by a Chinese company. If we had any other type of company, there would have been opposition, but not hostile opposition. So that's what we are up against. And we had to come up with a strategy to manage that environment. So we did more research. And we were able to ascertain two key things. The more we layered on economic benefits, the more we could show that it was consistent with our trade policies in terms of expanding our partnerships in Asia and around the world, reducing our dependency from the United States, increasing in jobs and bringing more investment into Alberta, support for the transaction went up. But the other learning that we had when we did this research is Alberta had different attitudes than the rest of Canada. They were much more pro-investment, foreign investment didn't bother them so much. Now, in the Investment Canada Act, the approval of the host province is critical. So we knew that if we got the province on side, it would make it very difficult for the Harper government to turn it down. The next thing we did is we listed all of the various risks that would be associated with this particular transaction. The biggest risk was, frankly, the Tory caucus. There is a constituency in that caucus that has been quite vocal in its opposition to Chinese investment, and we weren't frankly sure how much weight they had with the government. And that constituency went into overdrive because there are a lot of constituencies in Canada that got behind these Tory MPs and really egged them on, gave them more information to bring to the government to try to prevent this transaction from happening. So we knew that was going to be a likelihood. We scored it a medium risk, and it turned out to be quite a high one. But we thought it was going to be manageable. It turned out it was manageable, but just barely. We'll get to that part of the story in a second. There were other risks. These are just three. At the end of the day, the United States turned out to be a real problem. Even though it was headquartered here in Canada, the oil wells that Nexen owned in the United States were very close to the strategic sea lanes off of Florida and in the Gulf of Mexico. And the Department of Navy freaked when they learned that a state-owned Chinese company was going to be buying those properties. That became a real problem. So we set for ourselves a series of objectives. One, we had to make CNOOC a qualified buyer of Nexen. So what does a qualified buyer mean? It's basically, you've heard this term used before, you know, it's obtaining that social license to operate in the country. So we had to work to get Aboriginal groups on side, community groups on side, very supportive of this type of transaction. Secondly, we had to use the investment to help sell the China diversification story. Every Canadian government wanted to diversify into Chinese trade. So we made that one of the objectives. And thirdly, of course, we emphasized the quantifiable economic benefits of the transaction. Now, as communicators, the first thing we do, of course, is we try to come up with simple messages that we use to communicate to all various stakeholders, including the media. So our messaging, and you see Charlie and Dragon, prior to any transaction, the bankers always have code names for the acquirer and the acquiree. Charlie, in this case, was CNOOC. Dragon was Nexen. The key messages were that CNOOC was acquiring Nexen to diversify its resource base around the world. Reassuring. Every oil company does that, whether it's state-owned or not. That this transaction would be the start of a new era of economic diversification and trade with China. Right? Every government wanted to do that. That Canada would become a hub for all of CNOOC's transactions and operations in the Americas. So the head office in Calgary would expand from not just heading up Nexen, but the entire CNOOC empire across the Americas. Alberta government loved that. And then finally, that the monies that are coming into Canada and Alberta would be used to more fully develop the resource basin with the oil sands. Those were the key messages that we used in all of our communications across our program. So, obtaining approval for a complex transaction of what is arguably a national champion is not an easy thing to do. I've already mentioned the first thing you have to do is motivate the target to actually bite. And to do that, CNOOC had to pay a lot of money. Secondly, you had to obtain that public acceptance, which means you have to spend time talking to labor groups, advocacy groups, media. I've already mentioned various communities. And then, of course, during that next phase, where you're filing your submission to the Government of Canada, you're spending a lot of time talking to people who are lobbying the government, trying to influence the outcome of the process. Now, when you enter into the Investment Canada queue, it's about a 75-day process once you file. We are closer to 120 because the government can extend at their call the adjudication process if things get a little hot for them to handle. In this case, that's exactly what they did. This just gives you an indication of the detail, the granular detail that we have to plan and execute when we do one of these transactions. We have to develop all the various tools and communication methods to speak to the various publics that are affected by these transactions. I was back and forth to Beijing 14 times during the course of this transaction, and our clients wanted to know every single detail before we were allowed to execute this particular plan. Now, I talked about the importance of pre-engagement, getting government on side and comfortable with theoretical investment before the balloon actually goes up. The second most important thing about any one of these transactions is how successful the initial announcement is. So anytime you go to war, right, your strategy changes almost as soon as there's an engagement. And that pretty much happened in our case as well. So we had to plan everything from all of the media relations to employees, governments. We had to train all of the CNOOC spokesmen. We met with government ahead of time. We took them through the messages so they were comfortable with what to say once the transaction was announced. We did the investor calls. Everything was stage managed down to minute detail in order to give this whole transaction the best possible start for the debate that was going to be ensued. And then after the transaction was actually launched, of course, we spent a lot of time putting out fires, monitoring what was going on, giving additional information to people who were concerned about the implications of the transaction in Canada. So what was the outcome? Well, we were successful. We got approval. That's the good news. The not so good news is we created such a kerfuffle that the government decided that they had to change some of the criteria for state-owned enterprises investing in Canada in the future. And so they brought down some additional regulations that prevented state-owned enterprises from investing in the oil sands, unless they were in a minority or a JV. They increased the limits on state-owned enterprises' ability to acquire Canadian companies without going through a very laborious investment approval process. And they layered on a national security test, which they never explained what would be involved with. In other words, with national security, you can decide to turn something down and never explain why it is you're doing it. Shortly thereafter, Chinese investment in Canada dried up. So if they wanted to turn off the pipe, that was their goal, they successfully did that. So CNOC got their deal, but the Tory caucus won as well, because from there on in, it became very difficult for Chinese to invest in anything terribly significant in Canada. Now, I should tell you as well some recent developments, because the story, I'll close on this, is not so happy, really, for CNOC. After paying a lot of money for this company, you probably aware, but there's no pipeline to Asia. They can't get their oil out. They do train it to the United States and truck it, but they came to Canada in part on the promise of a pipeline that would go west. That never happened. And then commodity prices, of course, crashed as well. So today, the value of Nexen is roughly half of what it was when they purchased the company back in 2013. And so if there's a moral to this story, is that government approvals never guarantee financial success. You get in that queue and you try your very best to meet all the different political concerns that those politicians, those animals in the zoo have, and you quickly find that you price yourself out of a market. And that's pretty much what CNOC did. If they could sell their investment today, they would. But there are no buyers because they can't get the oil out. Thank you very much, everybody.